Hi friends, this is the part 2 video of the Let's Compare series, comparing 3 outstanding television models of 2014. And as you know, in the part 1 video, we have started the comparison and we have reached so far till the 3D segment, I mean the 3D quality of these 3 TVs. And as I stated in the previous video, this is a pretty long video, so I have tried to minimize the length of the video in part 1, and in this I expected a part 3 also, but I think I could wind this whole thing up by this part 2 video itself. So this is gonna be a pretty lengthy video, around 30 minutes, but I think I have tried my best to keep it enjoyable and watchable. And as I said, when it comes to active 3D, usability is the main issue over there. And while considering that, for example, you take a scenario, you are, if you are a person who used to watch movies or something in a couch, or you will be changing your viewing angle at present, means at times you will be shifting your position, at times you will be looking outside something, and then you will be looking back to the TV or something like that, then active 3D is not so recommended. Active 3D is only recommended if you're just like, you will be seeing the TV all the time. But what happens is, if you're using an active 3D glass, you're looking at another person, or if you're looking at some light or bulb in the room, then what happens is there will be flicker effect, because the frequency at which the shutters, the active 3D uses the shutter glasses, so the shutter glasses, the frequency at which the shutter glasses are paired with the TV, if that changes at any point, then you will feel some nausea or faint or something like that, because it actually changes the viewpoint of the person. So that it's like you will feel very bad at times if that pairing mechanism goes wrong. But for passive 3D, there is nothing like that. It's just a normal glass. They are using the layering mechanism and they are using the FPR for operation. So what happens is, there will be left and right eye images, and only the perception is important, nothing related to the technicality of the stuff, because there is no technicality. The technicality goes in the screen, that is the IPS panel with the two layers. So on top of the normal layer, there is a layer that is meant to support the vertical and the horizontal lines with the 3D supporting. So that's it. And another factor is, in LG, there's a limitation, like only WMV and H.264, that's the MPEG 4 is supported for the 3D. And here they haven't yet talked about anything, like there is no format specification, means I think by default they are supporting every format. So there is one thing I missed before, I think now I saw that, the local dimming factor. All the televisions are equipped with local dimming, so there is no nothing special, but Samsung comes with the micropixel local dimming, as what they are calling it. I don't know whether there is any significant difference, because I didn't find any significant difference when it comes to the micropixel local dimming that they are mentioning. Okay, our final verdict on 3D, it's the same as I said. Samsung had certain problems in crosstalks, as I mentioned. Sony, it's actually comparable to LG, but there is something like I was able to see the crosstalk effect in Sony. So I would recommend LG if you are a 3D fan, without doubt. And third thing is the smart TV. And when you're going for the smart TV platform, so there is no doubt, okay, when it comes to smart TV, it's LG, because of the webOS, because there is nothing that can equivalently compensate for the webOS effect. That's what we could say. But there is one thing, how far will you be using a smart TV, or how far will you be using the particular features or particular applications that are available as part of a smart TV? That is the question. If you're not a person who used to watch YouTube, or who used to watch Dailymotion, or who used to watch a lot of TV series, who used to go out of the box for some information regarding a particular program you're watching, then smart TV won't be making a real effect in your TV watching scenario. But if you are a person who actually would like to explore something in between, or you would like to watch YouTube, or you would like to watch Dailymotion, or you would like to continuously watch some TV series, and you are having a very good internet connection at your home or at your workspace or wherever you want to use this particular TV, then smart TV is very good. The minimum qualification for using the smart TV, okay, is the availability of a better internet connection. Because I'm saying it from my own experience, if you're not having a very good internet connection, it's not so good. Because I had a very low speed internet connection at first when I started using the smart TV platform. But when I found it's useful and it's having some potential and it's potentially reducing my effort every time I need to copy the to the pen drive or go for a TV series, I need to download everything. So this minimizes the whole thing. So what that means is I can directly stream the videos from the TV itself. So that actually reduces my effort, reduces the complexity of the stuff. And even for example, for my parents, I would say they were fed up with the copying, coming up with this pen drive, using the computer, all this stuff. But once I told them, you go to YouTube, search for the particular movie you wanted, you will be getting a result, click on that, you will watch the movie. So they were like, yeah. So that's the difference. So irrespective of the television, I would say for Samsung or Sony or LG, smart TV is having a future, I think. And it all depends on how simple it is. And that's why I told, when it comes to the simplicity, when it comes to how effectively you may use this, I would recommend LG's platform, the WebOS platform, because of the simplicity and ease of use, especially the voice recognition and all. But when it comes to Sony, what happens is there is a very good TV, there is a very good technically featured TV they are having, but the smart TV platform, the Sony Entertainment Network that they are having, it's not up to the mark, I would say, because they had past 3 years, I think, but they didn't refine the platform is the same. There is no refinement, there is no particular update, they are not supporting. For example, you could take it like the HEVC codec. They are not yet supporting the HEVC codec, but LG does, and Samsung, I think, they are planning to support HEVC or VP9. VP9 is the particular codec from YouTube, I mean the Google. Google come up with a live stream broadcasting platform which is called VP9, which actually supports the MS-10 from the DTS laboratory. Means you will be getting a very high quality video and very high quality audio at a very low bit rate. I mean the total bit rate of the file will be under 1.5 megabit. Means if you divide it by 8, what you will be getting is, if you are having something above 512 kbps connection, you will be able to stream a full HD video. So that's promising, right? So that is the kind of advancement that is happening in the technology. But Sony is not up to the mark when it comes to those kind of stuff. So you don't have to worry. What happens is, get a Chromecast, okay? So that will solve the issue. If you're going for Sony, you need the feature, there is no problem, there is no setback for you guys. You could just get a Chromecast or a Roku. They're both supporting this HEVC VP9 codecs, and you may use that for streaming purpose. But the only problem you will be facing is, some of the countries are locking this Roku or Hulu Plus or Amazon Fire TV or something like that. The platform is locked at some point. So if you're in those particular countries, this will be a problem. If you're not in those particular countries, I think that this is very good. This is just my personal opinion. All I'm sharing is my personal opinion. But I think for some people, this all depends on the taste of the person, how complex you would like to make this thing. If you want it simple, I think I would recommend LG. But if you could get Roku and there is no locking or something mechanism that is going on, I think even Sony is okay. No problem with Sony. I think I would recommend Sony, because get a Chromecast and that will solve the issue. There is nothing complex in that also. But Samsung, I have seen the platform, they're having a lots and lots of features, lots and lots of apps, lots and lots of content available. But what I could see is a mess. Okay, I think, okay, I'm saying it out of my mind. what I saw there was a mess. That's why I just even I felt like the smart TV platform was very good, but then I took a step back because my family didn't like the kind of mess that was present over there. My mom said like, no, I don't want that platform because look at that. How can I identify a particular application? How can I search for a particular application like that? They were yelling. So it this is like you if you need to prioritize your requirements. I think that's my personal suggestion. I would say while you're prioritizing, you will get a very good answer for the kind of priority that we're using. So so along with that, the smart TV platform, when it when it is compared with the Sony and Samsung, okay, we will take Samsung mainly consists of a smart TV for multimedia apps, news, social, fitness, Skype. What is that? All these corresponds to the apps. And smart interaction, what is that? Smart interaction means there is a voice recognition factor, there's a face recognition factor, and there is a motion control recognition factor. Whereas some face recognition and motion control recognition requires a separate camera. So this is present in Samsung and LG, both supports smart interaction, and it's the same. There is nothing different, but Sony doesn't have that. That's the difference. And the smart convergence, the condensed streaming, screen mirroring, smart view, all these uses the Wi-Fi direct or Wi-Fi or sometimes Miracast. But Miracast is present only in LG. It's not present in Sony. Means either one of these is present in Sony. Sony never supports all this stuff. Only what it supports is Wi-Fi direct, Wi-Fi directivity. Then what it supports is MHL. MHL is also supported. Screen mirroring is supported, but we are, I mean, via Wi-Fi direct only, not Miracast. And okay, when you're coming to Samsung again, the DTV tuner we have already seen, and the HDMI ports. HDMI actually 4-port, 3-port. I think a 2-port is enough in HDMI. One and ARC support is necessary, or it's very essential in the coming decade. What happens is, using ARC you could control multiple devices. That's the advantage. For example, if you're having a TV, if you're having a home theater, if you're having some other device you need to control a particular device, you may use the ARC for pairing between devices, and you could use it like, for example, in my case, I could say I'm having an LG TV, I'm having a Yamaha home theater, I'm having another set-top box, I mean two set-top box. So what happens is, I could switch on, switch off set-top box, home theater and TV with one single press of a remote button, because I have paired it using ARC and have enabled the HDMI ARC control on my home theater and set-top box. So that is the advantage what you will be having. Is it means, even though it is not so advantageous to you, it's advantageous to your family members at least, I think. What happens is, for my mom or father, they're not worried about switching on or switching off the TV, because with just one press of a button, they will be able to get back to where they were or what they have been watching. So that is the advantage. It simplifies. That is the advantage of ARC. It simplifies. And okay, coming on to this, the application, most of the people, okay, most of us would like a media player inside the TV, right? I think for in my case, it was a necessity. Like it's a necessary, it's a must have feature. If the feature is not there, I'm not going for the television like that. What's so special is, regarding LG SmartShare, SmartShare is a very good platform, and it supports the Miracast, second display, NFC, and in LVD. Among this, NFC, don't fall for the gimmick, I would say, from LG. NFC is not working. Their application is also not working. The developers are not supporting the application. So if you're expecting NFC in the LG, it's a mistake. NFC is not supported. And second display is yet to be updated. Like what it says in the website, it is not yet updated. Okay, I bought the TV in June, and till now there is no update regarding the second display. But YD, it is supported. Miracast is supported. MHL is supported. So I won't say LG is a total fail. They are successful, and the SmartShare app is very good. It supports a bitrate of 20 megabyte. Means, after 20, a video audio file makes, for example, you are having an MKV file, the bitrate of the MKV file should be less than 20 megabyte for it to be played in the TV. What that means is, if you are inputting a 40 GB Blu-ray file into the SmartShare, it won't be playing that file. because the bitrate will be about 20, means it will be around 27 to 35 megabytes. So it has to be under 20 megabytes for SmartShare to play that. Another advantage is you may use the SmartShare as a media server. And Samsung, they had that before. I mean, sorry, that was a mistake. They never had that before, but now they introduced it. I think because of the competition they felt from the different platforms, they introduced the SmartShare platform into this. And the Sony, they are having the Sony Entertainment Network, which is a very good SmartShare platform. The difference is Sony Entertainment Network possesses the contents from outside. Means they are having an entertainment network website of their own, so they can get the quality contents from their own website. That is the advantage they are having, whereas Samsung or LG doesn't have that advantage of own content platform. But what they will be giving us is different applications for obtaining the contents. So if you compare the SmartShare, I will give Sony a plus one, Samsung. But when you compare the kind of features inside all these, means for example, if you're comparing the search function, or if you're comparing the rating function or something like that, all these applications, it all depends on your taste. Means while you're demoing, you get a taste of how this whole thing is working and how complex it is, and how easily they are pairing, or how easily they are connecting each other like that. So that all depends on your personal taste, I would say. In my case, I am telling you, if you're comparing that particular feature wise, if you're comparing this thing, I would give Sony a plus one, Samsung a plus 0.5, and LG a plus 0.5. That's it regarding the SmartShare application. And Time Machine, okay, this particular feature, it's a recording feature, right? So the only thing is, regardless of the TV manufacturer, this thing works only if it is an RF or composite input. So that is one factor. Then external hard disk support is there for every manufacturer. The limit is 2 TB. Some of the guys during my some of videos, they were like, Western Digital hard disks were not accepting, I mean, they were not detected inside the TV. So my recommendation is, most of the time it will be detecting, because in my case my hard disk was Seagate Backup Plus 1 TB NTFS formatted, and it was detected with an ace. No problem was there. I won't recommend using the hard disk drive even though, because it corrupted my hard disk, and I was like, it was not detected after I used it in the TV, and then I tried to use it in the laptop, and the particular hard disk was not detected, and I used the Windows repair tool for repairing, and then only it was detected. So later on, I didn't use my hard disk directly on TV. Instead of that, I used my pen drive to connect to the TV. So what that means is, you may use the pen drive instead of hard disk. So that is not a feature which, at least in my case, I would say external hard disk support is, yes, it's good, but it's not a very encouraging feature, I would say. But instead of, but keeping that in mind, I could say one thing. All this supports recording feature, but that feature is of no use, because if you're using an STB, or if you're, I mean, the set-top box from a DTH operator or a cable operator with a digital cable, then unless there is a coaxial input port which could possibly be connected to either one of these televisions, then this feature is of no use. Means if you want to record, you need to have an RF input or a coaxial input. If the input is from HDMI, I mean the interface you are going to connect, using to connect the television to the set-top box or whatever input source you are having is HDMI, then this won't work. The recording feature won't work, and you won't be able to take the recording outside. Like, it's the same in all the televisions, because it's a DRM, it's a digital rights management principle. It won't be allowed outside, right? So yes, when it comes to USB, all the TV supports Dolby Digital, DTS, PCM, AJS, ES, E3 and all, except Samsung is having the uplift when it comes to audio, Sony is having the uplift when it comes to the picture, and the amount of content that is available, I mean the amount of support that is available. And special features are power saving features. So there will be a separate video on power saving within 1 or 2 weeks, because most of the time we won't be noticing the amount of power that is consumption. I mean the amount of power consumption that is available. So the power consumption of a TV directly depends on the kind of object that is displayed on the screen. If it is a static or if it is a moving, the power consumption varies. And plus there are different kinds, like the backlight, the amount of backlight you're using to power the television, that is very much important. And likewise, the input labeling you're using, the emanualization you are using. And when it comes to Sony, you could take a look at this. The power requirements for Sony is 106 watt. When it comes to LG, it is I think it is around 100. Okay, they are not specifically mentioning the power consumptions, but I could say, since I own the TV, it is consuming 1 ampere. 1 ampere is the current rating for LG TV. And for Samsung, if you're taking a look at Samsung, it is consuming the same amount of power as Sony. So Sony and Samsung both are around 120 watts, and LG, from my own experience, I could say if it is used at full backlight with 3D on, the power consumption will be around 190 watts. And if it is used in a normal backlight, means in a normal backlight condition, if you're using it around 40 backlight and normal present condition with an echo sensor on, then the power consumption will be under 68 watts. So that's what I could say. And so I think power consumption wise, all these are performing almost the same, except Samsung. It's certainly an underperformer when it comes to this power consumption fact. So terminal side, 3.3 here, and in the other case it was 4. That is advantage. And there is a USB 3.0 port, I think, in the other one. Let me check one more time. I'm not so sure about the USB 3.0. Okay, sorry, that's a mistake from my side. There is no USB 3.0, but audio out wise, if you're taking the port, headphone out port is very much useful. It is present in LG, Sony and Samsung. Audio out is present. Digital audio output is present in every TV. RF connection is supported. Composite connection is supported. Ethernet connection is supported by every television. Yeah, there is USB port. There are HDMI connections, and there is analog audio inputs for HDMI port only in Sony. And next factor is cabinet description and all the other factors, which are not so important, I would say. And okay, that's it. That regarding the technicality of the television, that's it. So what is the final verdict? Oh, we have gone through a lots and lots of factors, right? So what can we say regarding this? What is the final verdict for this when all these televisions are compared? So there are three things I would say. One is what is important for you. That is the first thing. What is important? Whether it is the picture quality is the important stuff for you, whether it is the 3D feature that is important stuff for you, whether it is the connectivity, Wi-Fi Direct, Miracast, YD chipset, NFC or whatever is important for you, or whether the total operation, means the value for money factor, is important for you. So that is what decides this thing. I think that is why I said in the beginning, every TV possesses its own unique features and unique qualities. But if you're taking this comparison, I will simply rule out Samsung because of several negatives. And when it comes to LG and Sony, it's a head-to-head. Both are having its own advantages and its own disadvantages. For example, LG is having low contrast because they are using IPS panel. So but the viewing angle will be very good in LG because of the presence of a IPS panel. So similar to that, Sony, since they have a triluminous display, the color reproduction is very, very good, and they're always outstanding. But is that present in LG? No, it is not present in LG. So LG is having a drawback over there. But when it comes to smart platform, again LG comes back. So it's like a give and take. That's what I could say, because the model that was first introduced is 750T from LG. They later on, Sony felt the pressure because the model that was present in the market was W800B. So because of the pressure from LG, because of webOS and the other several features, I mean the very important feature set, they introduced, Sony was Sony introduced the model W900B with a very good price tag, I would say, because it is very, very tightly competitively priced at 82,900. You may get it around 73, 74, I think. And this television, you may get it around 64, 63, because LG is not having that problem of handling, I mean, price handling. Means that the dealers are not having the strict monitoring like what happens with Sony. Sony always monitors how it is being sold in the market. They won't allow the dealer to go beyond a particular limit, right? So that's what is the ultimate difference in the pricing. So I am not discussing pricing here because it varies from state to state, it varies from place to place, it varies from store to store, and it varies according to the condition. It varies from time to time, right? So I'm not taking price point at any in this particular comparison. But if you're comparing other stuff, in my case, I took LG. Why I took LG means it because of my own personal reasons. It's like it suited my requirements, it suited my taste. It suited my family, it suited my environment, means the environment in which I am using is a white rectangular room, so it suited that. So that's what matters. I mean, at the end of the day, what it matters is more than how much money you spend, are you satisfied? Is there any regret for you? No, you shouldn't have any regret. If you're taking the TV of your choice, then I think there won't be any regret unless you are making a bad choice, I mean a wrong choice. So I think that's very important when it comes to selecting the television. Always stick on to what is important for you. So if what is important for you is the smart TV platform and 3D, I would recommend LG without any doubt. But what is important for you, if smart TV platform is not so important for you, yes, the ball directly goes to Sony, because Sony is very good at picture quality. They are having a very good TV, they are having very good feature set. The only thing they lack is the smart TV feature. I mean, the smart TV platform is very, very underperforming when it is compared to LG. So I think that's how we could differentiate. And regarding picture quality and all, the refresh rate and all, there is nothing much you need to worry, because the technicality, specifications, everything does matter only on paper. If you are going directly over there comparing the television, what you could see is Sony is a bit oversaturated and it will be performing really better in a showroom. Samsung will be performing average, LG will be performing above average. So that's what you will be experiencing. So the above average factor, above average factor is not a deal breaker for LG because of the presence of WebOS and all those stuff. Plus, the smart TV is not a deal breaker for Sony because of the extremely important picture quality that you will be getting in Sony televisions. And another factor you may compare is the dealers. I mean, the kind of service they are giving, plus the extended warranty. The extended warranty is very, very important because the parts cost for each of these televisions, once it's having any problem, any hiccups you will be facing, the parts cost is very, very high. So either you will be replacing the TV or you will be replacing a particular part which costs something more than 10,000 or 20,000 rupees. So extended warranty is very, very important, and it will cost you 4,000 to 5,000 rupees for sure. For 42 inch, I'm telling, for 32 inch or other ranges, I think it will be plus or minus 1K to 2K. So that's it for this particular review session. I think, hope you would have got some idea. So is there any if there are any doubts regarding the technical specification or what we have discussed here, or anything you would like to discuss, yes, I'm open here. You may come over to the comment section, we could discuss. And if there are any mistakes, just point out, because I could use my annotations to indicate the same to other viewers, because they won't get mistaken, right? If there are no intentional mistakes, but yes, obviously this, I am a human, right? So there may be mistakes. So if there are any, just point out the same also, no problem in that. There is nothing wrong in that, it's always appreciated. So thank you very much, guys. Thank you for watching this. And I think this video, this should serve the purpose. That is actually my intention. This should remove some confusion from some of the minds, I think, because there were so many questions in my channels regarding this particular 3 TV television models. So I think that's for it. It's time to say goodbye. So stay tuned, guys. There were so much more coming in my channel. So much more. I'm planning a live event also. So the hiccup, as you know, in my case, the internet connection. So anyway, we will see. We will see soon. So thank you for watching. Hope you enjoyed. Stay tuned. Cheers. Okay.